Hello, my beautiful people. My name is Oso Katel. Welcome to another episode of Basic Nigerian History. Now, last episode, we discussed how the first three main political parties came about. This episode, we're going to discuss the road to independence and the British attempt to convert the whole of Nigeria into a self-governing nation before pulling out. In 1951, the population of Lagos had doubled from 126,000 in 1931 during Camon's government to 274,000. In 1954, a constitution known as the Lesotho Constitution put a proper federal structure in place, and Nigeria became a federation of three regions, and Lagos became a federal territory. Side note, there were actually two constitutional conferences refereed by Oliver Lyttelton, one held in London and another in Lagos between July 1953 and February 1954. Anyways, let me try and give you guys a basic summary of what the Lyttelton Constitution said, because I tell you, I've read it and the political jargon can be so necessary, eh? Basically, the new constitution stated that Nigeria would have one central governing body, which would have 184 members, 92 from the north, 42 from the south and west, 6 from British Cameroon and 2 from the federal capital territory, which was Lagos. So basically half from north and half from south. The executive council of the central body would be made up of 3 ministers from each region, appointed by the party leaders, 1 minister from Cameroon, the British governor general and 3 other official British ministers. The constitution said that the federal government, meaning the one for the whole of Niger, could only pass rulings on things that was already on some exclusive list that they had. If it wasn't on that list, then it means it was the responsibility of the regional governing bodies. If the things on the list ever overlapped, then the federal government would always come out on top and win. An example of something that wasn't on the list was the responsibility for budgetary management transferred from the federal government to the regional government. This increased public spending on services and projects. The constitution also gave each of the three regions the option to become fully self-governing, but they weren't forced to. However, even if they chose to, Nigeria would still be under British control regardless. Basically, the constitution gave nationalists like NCNC what they wanted, which was a strong central government, but also gave MPC what they wanted, which was great regional autonomy. In 1954, another election took place. MPC, NCNC, and AG continued to dominate in their respective regions. By 1955, the value of exports had increased exponentially to about £129 million. And in 1956, there was the commercial discovery of oil at Olobiri in Niger Delta by the Shell BP Development Company. Yay, even more prosperity. If only we knew that this discovery would only intensify the corrupt and negative aspects of our society. In 1957, Western and Eastern region of Nigeria decided to become self-governing. This was around the same time that the Southwest adopted the free universal primary education for all Nigerians in the region. In 1957, Alhaji Tafawa Balewa was named the first Prime Minister of Nigeria. He was a London University educated former secondary school principal. The choice of him was to reflect Nigeria's attempt at being truly unified. The fact that he was educated made the southern nationalist happy. Also, it didn't hurt that he was not from Fulani aristocracy and he wasn't Hausa. From 1957 to 1958, there were preparations in London for a new federal constitution. Nigerian delegates were selected to represent each region. It was led by Balewa of the MPC and included party leaders and premiers such as Awolowo of the Action Group, Azikiwe of the NCNC, and Bello of the MPC. In 1957, the Governor's Executive Council merged with the Council of Ministers to form an all-Nigerian Federal Executive Council. Balewa was appointed the Prime Minister and formed the coalition government that included both AG and NCNC to prepare for the British withdrawal. This government basically guided the country autonomously without the British help all the way up until 1960. In 1958, exploitation of Nigerian oil began at facilities in Port Harcourt. Oil income wasn't all that, but people became optimistic about finding more. At that time, about 5,100 barrels per day were being produced, and it brought in about 200,000 naira of government revenue. Now, I remind you, 200,000 naira was a lot of money back then because the naira was not as bad as it is today. In 1959, the North also decided to become self-governing. This was a rush thing. The North were still not ready. They hadn't had nearly as much experience governing in this new way like the South had. Anyways, Nigeria could now have elections for an even bigger and newer House of Representatives. This election will determine the makeup of Nigeria's first independent government. At the time, each party had slightly different ambitions. NPC campaigned for local issues, mainly in the north, but didn't want any new big changes to the status quo. NCNC backed creation of the Midwest states and wanted federal control of education and health service. The AG wanted a stronger government and establishment of three new states, North, East, and West. It also wanted a West African Federation that would unite Nigeria, Ghana, and Sierra Leone. The NPC won, and Tafawa Balewa became Prime Minister, and Azikiwe took a largely ceremonial role as an Indigenous Governor General. It was clear that during the 1950s, both the North and the South wanted different things for self-government. Southern political activists wanted educational opportunities and economic development. The spread of missionary schools and wealth from export crops meant they were committed to policies that would benefit the South as a nation. Yoruba and Igbo also had rivalries. Both sides were educated, and as British started to pull out, gradually they competed over political machinery, government jobs, funds for local development, market permits, trade licenses, government contracts, and even scholarships for higher education. The Northern Emirs, however, wanted to maintain firm control on any economic or political change. They were very, very traditional. Any activity in the North that included the federal government and therefore Southern civil servants was viewed as a challenge to the Emirs. Broadening the political participation was seen as a threat to the status quo. Expanding education and social services was seen as a threat to the status quo. Because of this, immigrant Southerners living in the North, which were mainly Igbo people, dominated clerical positions and trades. It should be noted that what the North wanted would have been better for the British, as it meant it would have been easier for them to extract what they needed from Nigeria even after the independence. And that's it for this episode. I think I'm going to leave it there for now because my voice is running out. Like literally, I can't feel my voice. Anyways, thank you all for listening and tuning in. Next episode, we're going to talk about what Nigeria was doing after the independence. Guys, don't forget to like, subscribe, comment, hit that notification bell to get notified whenever a new video comes out. We love you very much. Dos Katel. Oh, before that, also, we have a Patreon. If you would like to support us and show us love, just go to the link below, join the Patreon community, pledge however much you can, and do what you can. Much love. Dos Katel out.